He of course wanted to get a picture, but he is not HIPAA certified, so, and there's patient information everywhere, so we had to cover his eyes. He's also a big fan of movies, so we went to the CAB little Oscars event. He had a great time there. And then I was just chilling at the library trying to study with Herky, and two of my friends came and snatched him. Took him all the way from the library to, I think that's the Coralville skating rink. But he had a great time there. Great time. So I'm part of the MSA. We had a speaker come in to talk about misconceptions about our religion. This is after that, but Herky was pretty excited about that. Big shout out to Anier and Alex for making it out too. Thank you guys. Thank you. Great time there. And to my right, that's the MSA president. He snatched Herky just like everyone else that sees him. And then I had a ping pong tournament this weekend. I had my number one fan come and show some support. He actually saw my paddle and tried to flex on the table a little bit too. Got really excited. And then last but not least, I thought I'd put this at the end because, you know, gotta save the best for last. Herky was super excited about meeting the best committee in UISG, Sabak. So, unfortunately, he wasn't able to make it to the meeting, so he had to Photoshop himself in there. I didn't do it, it was all him. So, thank you guys very much. So Herky Sherry this upcoming week goes to a senior senator that sits on GR and internal for all of her work with the upcoming bylaw changes, and this goes to Jennifer Corney. All right, so we have a piece of legislation for old business. I believe it's SSR 13. Is there an author present?
Okay, while he's doing that, I'll talk about the legislation. So I wrote this legislation during winter break, and it's finally come to the floor. I'm really excited this to come here. To give you guys, you've obviously read the legislation, so to give you guys a little bit of a background as to why I wrote this. So as being a person that not only goes here to the University of Iowa, but has grew up here in Iowa City, instances of discrimination, especially in our community, affects me not only on a student level, but also on a family level, because my father is an employee here at the University of Iowa. Specifically, the two instances that I brought up in here are an instance of staff discrimination and faculty discrimination based on age and sex, or age and gender. So my father, to give a little context, my father was furloughed in the fall of 2017, and being a person that does not have a official college degree, it was really hard for him to find another position because he had so much experience being here as an employee for over 30 years at the University of Iowa, being the only place the place that he's called home for a really long time. And he had been so successful for where he was at, but since he was paid a lot and did not have a college degree, his position was ended. And so he experienced a lot of discrimination, yet he still persevered. Now has a job here at the university, so I'm proud to say that. But I wanted to put this out there because I think it just goes with saying that like we need to be making sure and holding ourselves accountable to fostering an inclusive environment here on all levels of the university, on staff, faculty, and student levels, and even in our community. The last whereas statement that was added just basically states that you guys. Basically states that this is not inclusive of all instances of see a lot of University of Iowa students and some faculty and staff as well join in on a Does UIWA Love Me campaign. I did not specifically comment on this, but I think it does show that there are more instances of discrimination than the ones that I have presented here, and they should all be taken as seriously as the ones that I have here. I just thought these would be very good representations of very public instances of discrimination that the university right now is trying to situate, find its way through, and determine whether or not there should be compensation for them. There is also edits to the thing. So, other than that, do you want to open this to
questions? What part were different?
The
Are there any questions for the auditors? Any questions? Cool, thanks. Good job.
Thank you.
All right, so now with that, I will be moving to a period of discussion. Also, first, another quick little thing before we start. Some comments about that I had when I had my office hours. With a lot of different senators, they wish that like debate and questions would be a little bit more regulated. So on my side computer, we'll be recording like how many times people speak on the roster. So that's why there's an extra computer here if you see me using it. So yes. What was that? No, just like to keep track to like monitor like how many times people are speaking to like not prioritize other people, but if other people aren't speaking to like, for our understanding, because a lot of the points that came up to Jacob and I were that like sometimes a lot of people, like there were a lot of hands and it was hard to keep track of the number of times people either spoke or like what order of debate, like things were going, and so I'll also be keeping order. So that's why I have the computer and that's why I have the roster. That makes sense. Any points of discussion? Senator Kasai.
I would like to just say that I am full support of this, and I want to thank Joseph for sharing that story. As we've seen last night, it's very hard to share your experiences, and I personally felt that last night, how this not only supports and pushes the non-discrimination policy, but also encourages it to be better, which I think is the most important.
Yes, another huge thank you to Joseph. I got to see it early on when he was writing it. It was like years ago. He's done a ton of work on this thing. It's so detailed, it's so comprehensive, and it's just a great reminder to the university, especially in light of recent events, that this non-discrimination policy is such a huge deal on campus, and we need to make our students, faculty, staff, our community feel welcome. So I'll be in full support of this resolution.
Any other points of discussion? Senator Montserrat?
Is it possible if we take a little time to look over the new changes just to announce them, maybe by the end of the process? Because I can't do that.
I can zoom in.
As well. It says, whereas these mentioned instances of discrimination are not inclusive of all the occurrences of discrimination on the University of Iowa campus, but rather very public examples of discrimination towards staff, faculty, and students.
Thank you. Any other points of discussion? Senator Lagadat?
I'd like to call previous question.
Previous question has been called. Is there a second? Seconded by Senator Wick. All those in favor of ending discussion over SSR 13? Please signify your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Any abstentions? Ayes have it. And the link is now open. business or old business, we will now be moving to a period of new business. Senator Berry.
I would like to make a motion to add a piece of legislation to the docket.
Is there a second? Second by Senator Carlin. All those in favor of adding a new piece of legislation to the docket, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
Want me to explain it?
Yeah.
So he has the right to give a speech about it, and then we can vote.
Does the senator who proposed an amendment? Does the senator who proposed an amendment like to give a speech about?
I would give a speech, but it would be more of like a short comment. So, the sustainability wants the Office of Sustainability and the Environment wants to add information about sustainability on the Success at Iowa course that you take before you come here as a freshman at the University of Iowa. And the deadline for proposals is this Friday. So we want this resolution to be included in their proposal to show that there is student support behind including sustainability initiatives. I can email out the legislation, but it will just be SSR 16 and be adding it towards the end. I don't see it as being something that people will find too out of the ordinary, but just know that it's just UISG supporting including sustainability information in the Success at Iowa course.
So since that already passed, Senator Sanchez? No, the motion already passed. So with that, we'll have it.
He gave a speech on, so now we would technically vote on whether we want to
okay,
add
we can
to
do
the docket.
It. Okay.
And Senator Berry to specify where he wants it on the docket.
Senator Berry, where would you like that to go to the docket?
After SSR 15.
After SSR?
So at the end of the docket.
So there's, okay, at the end of the docket. So with that, I will now take a motion. Or is there a motion to add that to the docket? Seconded by Senator Chi. All those in favor of adding that to the end of the docket for SSR 16, please signify your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Any abstentions? Ayes have it. Okay. So now we will be moving into new business for SSB 33, funding for the First Generation Summit under authors and presidents.
So my cortisol levels can't get any higher. I just want you to know. So.
Okay, hi everyone. It's us again, round three. I'm Alexia Sanchez, Student Life Committee Chair, and we can all go introduce ourselves. Cool. So as you can see on the screen, this is our updated version of the First Gen Summit 2019 legislation. We've made a couple of changes, and we have had a lot of discussions within the previous days with a lot of stakeholders in and outside of the organization. We're really excited with what we have come up with. Hopefully you all had a chance to take a look at it beforehand and get any questions answered. I know all of us did our due diligence of reaching out to people directly via conversations, via like email or in person. So hopefully many of the questions got answered. And then if anyone else wants to say something, feel free to. Cool, we're really excited and hope to get rolling with plans now.
Any questions for the authors or any last minute questions? Great, thanks. All right, so now we'll be moving into a period of discussion over SSB 33. Senator Kira.
I'd like to call the previous question.
The previous question has been called. Is there a second? Seconded by Senator Ruth. All those in favor of pending discussion over SSB 33, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
Nay.
Any abstentions? The ayes have it. We will be moving to a period of voting over SSB 33. The link is now open. Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? The legislation passes. All right, so next on our agenda is SSB 34, funding for OER. Does an author want to come up? Existing open source textbook for a course, not editing it, and then just doing some minimal things to adapt their course to the open educational resource, so students don't have to pay for a textbook, instead they can use this open source textbook. They can incentivize things like that, all the way up to creating, for a faculty member, creating their own open educational resource and using it as part of their class. And there are various award levels for that, as you've seen in the legislation, awards that will range from $500 to $1,000, and then all the way up to $10,000 for creation of materials for faculty, and that would pay for graduate assistance, hardware, software, research, publishing costs, book chapters, just like paying them for their time to create these materials, things like that. This project has been in the works for a while now. The UI Libraries has applied for grant funding from the deans, or from the provost, actually, the provost initiative fund, and they were able to receive $150,000 total, $50,000 per year for a three-year pilot program. So they've already received a lot of good investment from it. The provost and the Deans Council think it's a really important program. So I'm really excited to have them with Rewrite Sheet to help fund some of it. An initial $25,000 this year. We can reevaluate the success of the program as the applications roll out in spring 2019 and classes are starting to be taught in fall 2019 and spring 2020. And then from there, we can reconsider whether we should give more funding to the rest of the pilot program, because they were looking for $75,000 per year over the course of 3 years, split $50,000 PIF, $25,000 UIF.
this year and then look forward and see if next year's administration would be willing to give the money, because I don't want to put us in that sort of long-term bind just as this administration. I don't know if that makes sense to all of you guys. Sarah, is that anything you want to say? Okay. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
Would the author be willing to make your friend?
Yeah, of course. All right. Well,
can we make these during discussion? Oh, okay.
Yes, Ruth, Senator Kissinger.
Hi. So during this like pilot program, do we know what kind of resources or like OERs are going to be available? Like, are they going to be distributed equally between like all different types of departments, or like are we aware of information? So, for example, like, is the COIS department going to get just as many resources as like?
It's based off of who applies for it, and this is something that's been like widespread asked for from a lot of professors. But we don't have information on like X amount of STEM professors will apply.
I may just missed it, but where was the 25,000 number originating from?
Yeah, that's just from a lot of discussions with Mariah Burnett and UI Libraries. She initially wanted a budget of $75,000 per year for the first 3 years each of this pilot program. Not a lot of overhead costs. A very large percentage of that $75,000 would go straight into providing grants for this OER stuff. And we kind of negotiated with them that it should be $50,000 of the provost funding and $25,000 of USU funding, depending on, you know, based on our financial situations of both parties.
Thank you.
Yep.
Is there any particular way that they plan to market this to professors or teachers?
It's kind of being something that's handled like. The libraries are currently using their textbook affordability pilot. As far as we're concerned, and if necessary, I can look up for interest and if my answer doesn't suffice. But they use like a top-down structure. The libraries have a really, really strong communication system between a lot of professors on this campus, and specifically with deans and department heads. And that like line of communication has grown significantly in the past 2 years as they're working on textbook affordability, so this follows that exact same path of marketing.
Hi, so you might be more aware than I am, but do you know of any like open concerns as to why professors aren't using these materials already? Like, what is stuff preventing them right now from using these resources?
So a lot of times they would have to redesign their courses around them, or obviously they don't have the time or capital to create their own materials. I know a lot of professors would love to put together their own specific course materials for their course, make it a lot easier for them to teach the course and make it more affordable for students. But, you know, given everything a faculty member has to do, they don't have really have the time to redesign a course around a new open source material that maybe just popped up in the last couple of years. So this would hopefully be incentivizing them to do it, or maybe to hire someone to do it, or buy the resources that will allow them to do it. Go ahead.
And like most things in life, it comes down to lack of money.
Any other questions for the authors?
Thank you.
All right, seeing as there is no further questions, we will now be moving to a period of discussion over SSB 34. Senator
Smith. I'd like to call the previous
question. The previous question has been called. Is there a second? Second by Senator Lackadat. All those in favor of ending discussion over SSB 34, please signify by your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
Nay.
Any abstentions? The ayes have it. We'll now be moving into a period of voting over SSB 34. And the link is now open.
Yeah.
I've all voted who wish, I've all voted who wish, I've all voted who wish. And the legislation passed. Next on our new business list is SSR 14 Westside Food Pantry. Is there an author present?
Yes. Senator Smith.
Hello everyone, AJ Smith, he, him, his, Health and Safety Committee. So the Food Pantry East and the IMU has done some really great work this semester. Over 13,000 pounds of food have been given out to Hawkeyes just this last semester. Almost 54,000 pounds of food has been given away in the past 2 years by the Eastside Food Pantry. They've had 644 unique visitors this last semester and over 4,400 client visits in the past 2.5 years, which I think are pretty impressive stats. Now, Food Pantry East is expanding the Food Pantry's reach. They just opened on the west side in the past few weeks, and now we're doing a marketing push to inform the student body about this incredible resource that's at their fingertips. So this resolution will show our support of both Food Pantry West and our support of ending food insecurity in Iowa. So I encourage all of you to take a good look at it and formulate your thoughts. I'd also like to give a quick shout out. Our team has been working to make this reality for about 4 months now. So I want to give a shout out to Christian Zerbis, Kayla Carter, and Krista Bailey. We're all in the back. And also the large team that's been working kind of behind the scenes on establishing the Food Pantry West Side location. So with that, I'd be open to any questions.
Senator Osborne.
Oh, yes, Ben. What's the operation to for this new location?
Could you clarify
what a year, how much would it cost for this new operation?
Sure. I'd like to yield to Kayla Carter if you have any information on that.
Are you asking for like the cost of the setup?
Well, basically to have this program brought in around how much is this?
What's the estimate
cost?
In our budget, we had set aside $5,000 for the opening of the Food Pantry West location, and that is for the spring into the summer. So through the summer, that is our budget. So we can probably look at no more than $10,000 for spring, summer, fall. And that's how the West Side location is.
I'd just like to clarify real quick. This is coming out of Food Pantry's budget. Like, we're not funding this. This is just a resolution to show our support.
Yeah. Can I add to that? So the funding for the Food Pantry West was allocated to us last year when the USG administration increased our budget. So we already have that accounted for, and we are matching those costs with in-kind donations. We donated food, our space is donated. And some of the costs, the initial $5,000, I anticipate it to be less moving forward just because some of those were initial startup costs, like purchasing shelves.
So this is in the legislation. I think I have that it says it's going to be in the Pride House. So that's west side. I'm not sure the exact location, but it's right next to Peterson Hall. Yeah, but behind Slater Hall.
Any other questions from the authors? Author?
Thank you.
Discussion over SSR 14. Senator Rodriguez.
college student space here at the University of Iowa. By passing this resolution, this organization reaffirms to students that UISG is committed to backing solutions that address food insecurity.
Senator Kempner?
I would like to call the previous question.
The previous question has been called. Is there a second? Seconded by Senator Kuro. All those in favor of ending this question over SSR 14, signify your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Any abstentions? Ayes have it. And the link is now open. Have all voted who wish, have all voted who wish, have all voted who wish. And the legislation passes.
For USG, and this is just a resolution in support of committing the University of Iowa and students and staff and faculty to making the university a fair trade certified university. There are a couple of people here that can talk a little bit more about this if you're going to come up. Lauren is in Fair Trade at Iowa, and then Joseph is the vice president of Fair Trade at Iowa. So they're going to answer any questions that you might have that I can't answer, and then share also another statement from the chairperson. Is that their title? Okay. Awesome. So just a little bit of background about this. Fair Trade Campaigns is like a national campaign, and then like cities, schools, universities, organizations can become Fair Trade certified by working through a list of qualifications and passing a resolution from your organization's like governing body is one of the steps to achieving that certification. So Lauren, if you want to read that statement.
So I'll just be reading a statement from the chairperson of our board, Zach Rochester. First and foremost, the Fair Trade Movement seeks to cultivate a global society that has faith in an economic system that prioritizes people and planet over profit. Fair Trade at Iowa is a student org here at the UI that intends to create the same culture and mentality among our local community. By encouraging students, faculty, and the university itself to be more conscious consumers, we are able to begin sparking enthusiasm for the goals set by the International Fair Trade Charter, as well as the UN's Millennium Development Goals. Since the rise of neoliberalism, the consolidation of small-scale farming operations into large ones, and the competition of industrial-scale agribusiness has shaken the stability of rural communities in the developing world. The poorest of the world's poor have been brutally exploited or forced into cities already suffering from over-urbanization by global forces such as mechanization of agriculture, food imports, drought, or civil war. The world's wealthiest have, over the last several decades, made the lives for the world's poorest more and more unbearable. Fair trade practices are a small way to begin righting extremely prevalent wrongs. Further, by passing this legislation, the University of Iowa is one step closer to being designated a Fair Trade University by Fair Trade Campaigns USA. Not only would this designation attract incoming students who are passionate about social justice, sustainability, and human dignity, but would truly be a testament to the intentions and priorities of the University of Iowa. By making small changes at the university and by cultivating a more compassionate dialogue, We are able to improve conditions internally as well as externally. And also, Zach wants me to pass along the message that if you want to get into contact with them, just reach out to me. They're happy to answer questions.
Yeah, I think I have a question for the Fair Trade in Iowa people. So how do you guys respond to the criticism of fair trade in that it like disadvantages workers in agricultural industries in least developed countries because they don't have the infrastructure to adhere to the fair trade standards and like fosters inequality for those least developed countries?
So specifically what we're going through like with the fair trade campaign in the United States, like designation as a is that we will be buying goods necessarily that have a fair trade stamp on them from fair trade campaigns. So while that is a very important issue that is happening like within those countries and those developing nations, if we were to shift the paradigm of almost what things are to be bought in America, specifically at universities across the nation, that's going to lead to further action from other institutions. Because some institutions like those other in-state places, such as in Iowa, we can see that if we make those changes, then other places are going to make those changes, and that's going to lead to a ripple effect of, hey, maybe what consumers are looking forward to are actually advocating for fair trade and making it so that consumers are making proud consumption choices.
I have a follow-up. So would you say then that that ripple effect would cut like workers in agricultural industries in least developed countries off, cut their export arm market like off because they are no longer able to export goods because of that ripple effect, disadvantaging those workers in those industries?
So I think what like the reasoning for this resolution is to buy more goods that are sustainable because while, sorry, the University of Iowa is not going to dismantle capitalism, I feel like it's kind of important to shift towards like buying more sustainable, buying in ways that are going to help impoverish people all around the world. And while the exports will shift dramatically in the upcoming years as people look towards more sustainable and environmentally conscious decisions on what they buy, this is just a proper framework to not only create sustainable action across the world, but also make the University of Iowa to look like it celebrates diversity and helping people all across the world, which is a good look for Iowa.
I think a lot of the efforts of fair trade campaigns and Fair Trade Iowa are like making small steps towards more equity in your purchasing decisions. And that's like a very big global issue. But the intent with this organization is really just to like get a fair trade coffee in Union Station and little things like that to work towards that bigger ripple change. And then fair trade campaigns. If you want to go on their website, actually, if you ever have some free time and want to learn more about fair trade, their website's really easy to navigate, and they have a lot of information about, like, constantly working to get people to focus on buying fair trade, like products that are currently certified as fair trade, and then also working towards like dismantling the systems that keep people in slave labor and keep people in those countries from being able to be part of these systems. Does that help answer your question?
Yeah.
So like, I don't know if this is within the scope of your organization, sorry, it's the question, because I guess sort of anyone can answer it, but like, have you guys thought about like the balance between like buying fair trade and buying local?
Within fair trade at Iowa, specifically those with like chocolate and tea, and those are like predominant things here that would be like used in the university, and those things are not soybeans, they couldn't really be made local, so we're just advocating for things that are being shipped in from overseas and other neighboring countries, like less developed countries, looking towards those to be produced in a more equitable and sustainable fashion.
Also the specific like foods and stuff that we're looking at, I think it's important to note that the price differences are, a lot of people think that when you buy fair trade it's like more expensive, but that's kind of a myth. Like with the stuff we're looking at, I can't give specific numbers, but Zach would definitely be able to go more in depth with all of that.
So it has listed ways that the University of Iowa should dedicate itself to being more fair trade, and it's like really awesome ideas. I was just wondering if there's any action items that you would communicate with to have.
So seeing as like fair trade at Iowa is a relatively new organization, and Iowa as a whole wants designated university would be one of the first from the state. So as far as the action items, we're advocating for like creating more events on campus, which is one of the things needed in order to designate Iowa Fair Trade University, as well as speaking more explicitly as state with housing and dining and like with the leaders of the university itself.
And then Zach communicated to me when you're talking about like the certification, there's like very specific steps you have to have, and so a lot of it, like you said, would be like talking with housing and dining to change out, like, they said, like, in the places where we have Starbucks coffee, it would just be, like, purchasing the Starbucks coffee that is fair trade certified and not purchasing the stuff that's not fair trade certified. So it's very much, like, checklist oriented, and it's, like, pretty, not easy, I don't want to simplify it, but, like, it's simplified, so it's, like, definitely attainable.
So to clarify, it's more of like a checklist of things. It's not like 25% of our food items need to be fair trade.
Yeah, so like as an example, it's like things on the checklist. It's like create an organization with like 30 or so people. Like create a, like three events on campus per semester. And then one of them is to provide a resolution by the student government representing body on campus. So it's very just like, it's not like 25% of stuff has to be fair trade.
But we're definitely not going to stop there. That's just the first one.
This resolution checks the list, but it's so much more.
Any other questions for the authors?
I have a question about the wording in the resolution. One of the, like the first like point in section three says that the resulting costs do not significantly jeopardize board rate costs. So I'd just like to know what's that threshold for significantly jeopardize and like how students might see their costs affected. I know Lauren touched on it earlier, but just like maybe, like what does that specifically mean by significantly jeopardize?
So that means that this isn't gonna like change the cost of meal plans or anything. It's not gonna alter tuition, anything on that scale. Like Lauren said, it's like individual products, and so it's at like, while individual, like a granola bar might be like a couple cents more, it's not gonna severely affect any of the payments that students make. Also, this is the website. This is just kind of a look into, these are like the steps, and if you click on these, there's more details, but it's like, make a team, so have an organization. This is like guidance on how to reach out to campus partners. So this is like ensure minimum
minimum of two fair trade products are available in all campus-owned and operated venues. So in some venues, we're already accomplishing that, and some it's just one or two more, things like that. So all of these, there's like an outlined goal, and then how to meet the goal. And Fair Trade Iowa will be doing all that awesome work.
Any other questions?
Quick question. I don't know if it was mentioned already, but what are some steps that student government can do in the future to align with this resolution, specifically Sustainability Committee, and as well as other ones too?
I can speak on the UHG side, and if you want to talk about how your organization can be supported. We can definitely, if there's ever a time when the organization is facing backlash from any campus partner that isn't willing to work or make changes, we can pass resolutions, we can work on helping with housing and dining initiatives, because sometimes we have a little bit of a leg in that door. Yeah, we can just keep this kind of advocacy in our minds. Do you want to share anything else?
Yeah, so as an example of things that like student government has done in the past to like create like better changes within fair trade, this upcoming weekend, the organization Fair Trade Iowa will actually be going to the National Convention for Fair Trade Campaigns, and that was going to be allocated by student government. So trying to encourage the education that we as like the members of the organization have in order to benefit like, here.
Okay. Also, using like the UISG name if we're trying to set up meetings with housing and dining or like people to talk to can always help to get those like set up.
And going to campus events.
So in the stores section, it says the university will include fair trade food products, apparel, and handicrafts such as jewelry and other gift items whenever possible. Can you give us an idea of, you kind of touched on it a couple times, but how exactly buying fair trade products will or will not affect their students' constantly? Does that make sense?
Like, will they be more expensive in reward, please?
Yeah. So. By including, by having fair trade products, apparel, and jewelry, wherever possible, are you saying that that will not increase our students' cost of benefits?
Yeah, it won't affect. I mean, it's not going to affect any like student fees, meal plans, flex meal prices, anything like that. Are you looking for more information
than that? Like additionally, through creating like opportunities for apparel and goods and all sorts of stuff like this to be available on campus, it's gonna be like the option like Sarah at Union Market or something. You're like, wow, that looks like a cool chocolate bar. Let me get that. It's like the consumer's decision. It's just creating opportunities for students and faculty alike to be able to make the decision for them.
Yeah, the goal is not to like take every single product off of this campus unless it's fair trade. It's just to incorporate more fair trade items and, like you said, help consumers make that decision and like have that education opportunity available on campus. Jocelyn?
I don't know if you already answered this, and I'm sorry if you did, but what, have you had any conversations with Housing and Dining yet, or are you waiting for the resolution to initiate those conversations?
So, we have tried to facilitate a conversation with Housing and Dining, however, it's been difficult being like such a new organization. However, having the stamp from UISG would definitely make that a lot easier to ascertain.
So you haven't been able to get a meeting?
We've had meetings.
What did you say?
We've had like email discussions.
Oh.
And we've had like meetings about like having potential stuff, but like lots of student government.
Did they seem at all receptive to it, or were they more combative?
As far as stuff in like dining halls and stuff like that, they were very debating whether or not it would be economically feasible. However, they were looking towards like satellite dining locations such as like Market, like Pabst Diner and stuff like that. Those would be places.
Awesome, thank you.
Alexia?
to Jocelyn's question, have conversations been facilitated within student government representatives? So our director of sustainability or our sustainability committee itself prior to this resolution?
In terms of fair trade initiatives?
Yeah, and this resolution as well.
Yeah, we actually haven't talked as much about fair trade initiatives. I think this gives a good window into working more on them. And like that, in RDC, if we're part of that conversation, it may help a little bit. Some of us know how tricky dining is sometimes. But as far as now, we haven't done any fair trade initiatives other than this resolution.
So does Housing and Dining know that they're on this resolution?
It will be sent to them if it's passed. Oscar?
What are ways in which fair trade in Iowa has helped support increasing awareness of fair trade products, helping students become more aware of those, and then also helping students incorporate those products into their daily lives?
Yeah, I can just preface this, but this is, you can answer this. Fair trade in Iowa has been in work for a few months, I think, so not a ton of work has been done already. The hope with this resolution is that work can be supported.
So essentially, fair trade has really been going since November. So in terms of what actual events have been happening, we have tabled the IMU, and we are hoping in the upcoming weeks to table on the TN Clear Broadway in order to get the word out. And so this would be just one thing that would say, hey, let's get the ball rolling, let's continue this process. And once again, this resolution isn't designated 25% of everything has to do this. It's kind of just hey, fair trade is a good idea. Let's
Joseph, you mentioned in your answer to Jocelyn's question that HMP has some economic feasibility concerns. Would you expand on those a little bit?
So when contacting Housing and Dining, I guess they didn't blatantly say that there was economic feasibility concerns. It was kind of just this isn't really where we're going right now in terms of what we want, because they're really busy working on local, and once they get us, when working to change things. And so hopefully this brings in a new era of kind of the open discourse that we have in the future.
I'm hopeful as the collaboration continues, those concerns will be minimized. I don't know how familiar people are with fair trade, but I know when it comes in my mind, I think of health food stores and being really expensive, but that's not always the reality. And dining is always working to try to make food as affordable as possible and as best for students. And so that could have just been a concern that they thought they would originally have. But hopefully, as we express with the student voice that this is what students want, hopefully that would be a good tool in the conversation of this isn't where we're going right now. Because I know that's a pretty common response from campus partners, but if we keep pushing and say that there's student support behind this, hopefully that will help the conversation. Does that answer your question, Oscar? Oscar?
Going along with Fair Trade Iowa's goal of helping inspire other institutions to support fair trade, what conversations have been started with other local institutions to help them implement fair trade, fair trade organizations at their own schools?
As far as what fair trade campaigns has been
yes.
University student. So fair trade campaigns is very open to letting students choose what they want to do to allocate fair trade funding and stuff or just generally change their campus. So they have a bunch of resources online as well, with examples of events and what we can do on campus to provide education to those who don't necessarily know what fair trade is, as well as creating resources for students to learn more about it within their organization. So for example, going to a national convention to help those who don't know about fair trade.
And then just for reference, this is the universities, towns, schools, congregations that have already declared that they're on this path, not that have accomplished the certification necessarily, but have started it, so they have a few pieces of this path.
Senator Gingrich.
I'm in support of this resolution. Thank you guys so much for coming. Well, I guess we're here and here, but for talking to us about this. I think it's a really great first step for our university to combat this problem. So I'm definitely in support.
Senator Henry.
I'd like to thank Lauren. Is this on?
Yes.
Yeah. Lauren and Joseph for speaking up there. That's awesome to have the fair trade viewpoint of it, and you're really helpful in answering questions. I'd also like to just show support for the org and this resolution overall. It's a pretty new organization. Like you said, it was established in November, I think, and they've been working pretty hard since then. So this resolution will do a lot of work in terms of showing student support for this initiative, so it doesn't look like there's three people going into the entire Department of Housing and Dining and asking for something nobody wants. It'll really show that we support it and we know that it's best for our university. And a lot of those conversations that haven't been able to happen yet, hopefully will be able to happen after this, if this resolution is passed.
Senator Roof and Leahy.
I'd also like to support this resolution. I first learned about fair trade and the concept of fair trade universities when I was at a leadership summit last spring with Akash, who had talked about the importance of fair trade institutions and organizations. I think that, as was said in their presentation, it will attract a lot of new people to come to the University of Iowa, as a recruitment mechanism. And I also think it would help us expand kind of our idea of sustainability to include the social, economic, and environmental, all three prongs. So I'll be supporting this.
Senator Leahy.
I'd like to call the previous question.
Is there a second? Second by Senator Farland. All those in favor of any debate or discussion over SSR 15, please signify your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Any abstentions?
The ayes have it.
The ayes have it. And the link is now open.
Still waiting on one vote, so if that's you,
thank you.
Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? And the legislation passed. All right, we're going to be moving into SSR 16. Is there an author present?
Senator Barry, he, him, his.
And yeah, we just sent out this resolution. It's just to support work being done by the Office of Sustainability and Environment. They're submitting a proposal this Friday to include sustainability education in Success at Iowa. It would be in the form of about a 30-minute narrated PowerPoint similar to other Success at Iowa modules. Key concepts and learning outcomes are going to be decided after initial approval, but things that we would like to be see in there would be pillars of sustainability, some things about waste diversion and energy savings in the residence halls, and other applicable concepts for first-year students. It's supported by a number of other offices and individuals on campus, and I think that covers the majority of questions.
You can also see that I've made a follow-up email to what I sent when I sent out the legislation. That is the official proposal that the Office of Sustainability and the Environment will be submitting. So if you want to know specifically what they want to be included, our information is fairly general. It doesn't get down to the nitty-gritty, but that submission definitely gets fairly specific. So if you want to know about that, you can reference that as well.
Are there any questions for the authors?
I don't know if you mentioned this, but why wasn't this on the agenda before?
We weren't aware the proposal was due this Friday, and so it was a last-minute addition.
Did you know about the proposal at all? Like you, as in like the committee and all, not just you two.
Committee being Kevin, Yanni, and I, yes. I was told, well, Yanni told both of us, I believe at Saturday night, at like 12, so basically Saturday, Sunday, and I sent an email out to Connor at like 12:30, 12:45, and he responded very quickly saying that most likely it won't be on the agenda, but like we can make a motion to add it, and if there's time, by all means, to add it. So as we have all been enlightened that we can add legislation to the docket, that is exactly what we did, because we had time to do it.
Any other questions for the authors? Thank you. All right. Now we will be moving into a period of discussion over SSR 16. Senator Hamstring.
Hi. I just want to say that I will be fully in support of this resolution because the Sustainability Committee has been talking about including sustainable education into the curriculum of undergraduate body for some time now, and Senators Barry and Dehe sent out a draft of this legislation a couple weeks ago and asked for feedback from the group, and I think I speak for most of anyone we in saying that we support everything in this legislation.
Senator Henry?
I'd like to support this resolution too, and also say that Senator Barry and Senator Leahy definitely did a really good job assembling this with a limited time, just with the everything that was going on. And also this like education piece in Success at Iowa will be a really good like base knowledge for a lot of incoming students in terms of the initiatives and goals we have in sustainability and that we've had for many years. A lot of the projects that we're working on and goals we have will be helped a lot if freshman students can have this base knowledge coming into the university. So I'm really excited to see this happen.
Senator Barry, then Pokorny.
So I would just like to point out one specific part of this that I think is very pertinent to why we should include this information for first-year students. Our first-year students come from all over the nation and all over the world, and every place has different standards for what can be recycled, what can be composted. Some people don't even have access to compost before, so I think education when it comes to recycling and composting and waste diversion is very important, especially because Iowa City is very particular in what they accept and what they don't accept in our recycle bins. If you look on the second page at the top, there are diagrams. That is, if you look, these are for the IMU. On the ground floor in the compost, that green stuff is actually what is compost in that bin. Everything else is waste. So we are at about 50% contamination in our compost bins here in the IMU, which the accepted rate is 1%. So we are far higher than what we should be at. So that is all having to have to be thrown away because it cannot be composted. So we are trying to make it so that people that are trying to make an effort to recycle and compost, that they are their efforts are actually helping our earth and helping the university be better in its sustainability practices.
Senator Pokorny?
So,
the previous question was a call. Is there a second? Seconded by Senator Schnack. All those in favor of ending discussion, Schnack? Senator Schnack. All those in favor of ending discussion, please signify your vote by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Any abstentions? The ayes have it. And I sent you a link, and it probably is already open. So, is it already open? Okay, cool. I just forgot to click on, so.
Yeah, that's super exciting.
Also, shout out to Melissa, Sarah, Joey, and Catherine, who are really helping on this project. They deserve a lot of recognition for that. I just want to say thanks. I'm also looking for a representative to serve as a kind of liaison to the transfer think tank. Preference is given to transfer students if you are identified as a transfer student. If not, if you're interested, just email me. And then just again, basic academic behaviors from ASMR. Go to class, take good notes, do the reading before class.
I just had this random thought. So if you are new to USU this semester and you happen to be an email with your personal like bio information, please do that so I can get you up on our website.
I just want to do a quick update. If you haven't heard yet, OrgRoke is canceled for this semester. However, we plan on doing it in the fall. I will not be here, but there will be a committee formed for it. And the programming will still be in place. And the growth committee is meeting this Friday to decide the date, and there will be more updates to come. Also, please keep sharing the Facebook live feed when we do send it. Thank you.
As I put on the Facebook page, there's going to be a bill presented to you all next Tuesday, so a week from today, for a pretty significant allocation to the on-campus garden project. Thank you to the senators who have sponsored the legislation. I'll be having office hours for any questions, just since I've been most directly involved with the project since the beginning, 11 to 2 on Thursday, and then 11 to 2 on Tuesday. And then if those times don't work for you, please feel free to email me to set up like a one-on-one or just email me your questions. Thank you.
Justin, can you hold on for a second?
I think it's on the Facebook page too. Am I right? Or is it updated? Good. Okay. Hi everyone. My name is Jocelyn. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. For those of you who don't know me, just a few quick things. One, we're doing a voter task force to talk about our voter engagement, voter registration efforts from this past semester. So if you have any ideas for ways we could expand those efforts, especially off campus, or if you have any feedback from how it went last semester, please send me an email. It's just right up there. It's also just my name. Next, we're doing a Board of Regents letter writing campaign to connect students with Board of Regents members as they make really, really vital decisions that affect all of our tuition, especially. So for an example, it's just kind of like a pen pal thing. It's super easy. It'd probably take you like 20, 25 minutes to write one. If you're interested in writing one, please email Jennifer Corney. One final note, Connor's not here tonight, but I think Heath's going to give the overall GR update about what we've been doing at the Capitol. If you ever want to know more about GR stuff, but you're not on the committee, I just wanted to let you know that you can always reach out to me and set up a meeting, and we can talk about stuff that's going on or if you have ideas for new projects. Thanks.
And we won the best fresh check in the nation!
On that note, thank you so much for everyone who participated in that. And then also on the topic of mental wellness, we will be hosting Mochas for Mental Health on March 13th. So that will be starting at 8:30 a.m. on TN Cleary. If you sign up to volunteer, work the shift, you will get, of course, free coffee and donuts. Then it also counts as your office hour.
Ooh, free coffee with your office.
Okay, so thank you to everyone who's working on bylaw changes currently. A special note for the executives, if you have updates for your specific position, please reach out to a senator to work with them so that we can have that all consistently comes to legislation. So I'm asking for ball rolling once we have everyone in place.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hi everyone, Alex Bear again, he, him, his. It's been a wild week. I'm sure a lot of you read through the Does Who Our Alumni posts and shared them, and so many people in this room right now made their own posts. So if you haven't given those some love, please go ahead and do that. And I just want to highlight this event. I've been communicating with some of the folks who were the original organizers of this. I know Tristan was at that original meeting and can also provide some insight into the folks who organized the original campaign, but they would like to communicate with all of you that on Thursday on the Tea and Query Walkway, they are hosting an event, an official Does UI Alumni event with photo frames and I think perhaps also fundraising of some kind. The details are still in the works, I think, and that's going to happen at the exact same place and time as the protest last week. So please make sure to follow them on social media because their movement has been gaining a lot of followers and it's been starting a lot of conversation across campus, which is incredible, and it's gonna be good for us to keep in touch. Related to that, and for all of your friends or all of you who are more interested in representing the communities in USG that have been historically underrepresented, we have a final interest meeting for constituency center elections that was extended. We were originally going to do this, but we saw that there was a need in order to ensure that there were a lot of people running these elections. That's next Monday, March 4th, and there's going to be a mass email sent out the morning of March 4th. So in the meantime, we really need to hit home campaigning on our social media platforms and through direct contacts. Keep contributing to the Not Rich at Iowa guide. It's at 27 pages, and that's so cool. Wow. It's starting to really shape up, and I'm loving all the content I'm seeing. And finally, Thursday, the Board of Regents is voting on the Labor Center agreement. I just talked to Jen, who is the director of the Labor Center. Shout out to Lauren also, who's been working at the Labor Center long before involvement in USG. But she's virtually confident that's going to pass on Thursday, which will secure 4 years of sustained funding for the Labor Center to transition them to alternative funding source, which is a result of a lot of activism, including all of you students who have been interested in pursuing this. Thank you.
Hi everyone. First of all, I just found this earring on the ground. It's like a pearl with a little star thing. It's yours. I'll put it right here. I posted this on Facebook last week after we didn't have announcements, so if you want more information, I'll just say it quickly and you can go there. We've been reached out to about doing like a community event with it's like similar to what Environmental Coalition did last semester, like a trash crawl, a trash pickup thing, but with the Department of Public Safety, so like the University Police. And just some thoughts that come to my mind are like different like communities, comfort levels and like safety around police. So if you have like any thoughts on that to share with me, I'd really love to hear that because I want to like take a lot of different perspectives into consideration when we're thinking about planning this event. And then Sustainability Week will be happening in April. I think we'll have a more fun name than that, but that'll be for Earth Month, and there are a lot of different events with other organizations, and then we'll be having like a week of like celebrating those events, encouraging people to go to those, and then having some events and programs of our own. And we'll probably need volunteers and sharing for that, so just keep that on your radar. If you have any ideas of like educational things or fun events you want to have, or any way to make that better, don't hesitate to let me know.
Hi everyone, my name is Lauren Phelan, I'm the executive assistant, and I posted on Facebook, but the application for the Association of Big Ten Schools, APTS on the Hill, are due this Friday, and I encourage everyone to apply. They're looking for about two people, and you would leave Saturday, April 13th, and come back Tuesday.
Kyle Shear, cabinet director, he and his. I heard some confusion about UBTS in the office earlier, so to clarify, the Hill is in Washington, D.C. If you go to this link, we now have all of our meeting notes, Senate meeting notes, executive meeting notes from this year, and also back all the way to, I think, 2013. So you guys should go check that out. USG SharePoint focus group, next one's Thursday. It's the last one. You should go. It's a good time. IOID's website feedback, posted about this on the Facebook. You all got an email. I'd really appreciate to get as much feedback as possible by Wednesday at midnight so we can make those changes before the public launch in the next few weeks. Thank you.
I'm going to add something about Big Ten on the Hill. It's like a university-sponsored event. So if you have a news name you need to change or like an absence you need to excuse, it will work for that. So if that's what's holding you back, definitely let me know. I'll reach out to the professor to ask about it.
Okay, we're back. Sorry this is taking so long, but everything is on the Facebook page. We just sent Tristan just sent out an email. Please send just one email at some point tonight to your parents or your family friends, someone who could maybe be interested in donating to the Hockey Completion Grant. We'll probably do this again. The campaign's a month long, but just to put it on your radar.
And to add more information about kind of the students who are being affected by this grant is, from my last statistics, is about 48% are first gen. And the number of students, statistically higher number of students are underrepresented students and minoritized students. So just background about the kind of students you're helping. You said just one email.
Yeah. You can, if you want to put minimal effort into it, the second page of the Word doc that Tristan sent out is like a copy and paste. You can send it pretty much anybody you want. So, thank you.
Hello, everybody. Keith Schindler. He is the Campus Service Vice President.
Here, Mustafa, she's the first president.
So as Jocelyn alluded to earlier, we met at the state capitol again with some legislators. Some really great news with medical amnesty. The Senate file has now become a study bill. It's really good news. It was passed out of subcommittee about a week and a half ago, so really excited to see that happen.
Woo!
On the House side as well, that passed subcommittee this morning, actually right before we got there, which was also really exciting, so that is starting to move. I would encourage any of you, if you're from the state of Iowa, please contact your state legislators. Let them know that this bill is coming, if they're not, they don't happen to sit on the Public Safety Committee in the House or the Judiciary Committee in the Senate. Please let them know that this is a bill that's coming up and that they should support it and give them a few reasons why. We're really excited about that. And then we'll be continuing, again, to make trips to the state capitol every Tuesday. Please, if you haven't found the document on the Facebook page, if you're interested, feel free to sign up and come along with Connor and I. The Student Leader Roundtable for the month of February was held last week. It was on sustainability. Echoed a lot of the statements that we saw in some of the resolutions here tonight. Yanni, I think you'd agree, we had a really productive conversation with the Office of Sustainability and the Environment and the President's Office as well. So really excited to see some tangible change come out of that. And then the last thing that I wanted to mention, the Board of Regents is meeting Thursday, as Alex mentioned earlier. If any of you are looking to contact any regents, or if you have any initiatives that may pertain to them in the long run, please let us know before we go. We can search out specific regents and speak to them. Thursday morning, we have a full hour of their undivided attention, and we would love to bring some of your issues there.
P3, fill out the question document that Heath posted on the page if you still have questions about that, and he will chat about that with Terry Johnson, who came and presented. Fall in Love with Research Week happening March 11th through 16th. That's the official time. And there's going to be stuff up in the Kindle Gallery for y'all to engage with, as well as other events scattered throughout the week. I'm working with social innovation students. That's a class that Dave Gould runs to work on international student integration into our campus. And so we're hoping to plan an event, hopefully institutionalize something for us to celebrate international students and their identities on campus. And then just a quick note about Does UI Will Love Me, just wanted to thank anyone that has shared their stories and thank the people that started this campaign and for Alex for helping bring that to UISG as well.
Grodzki, Speaker of the Senate, he, him, his.
And Jacob Hyde, Speaker Pro Tem on the Senate, he, him, his.
So I didn't write anything, I apologize, but I have some notes. So we have 5 weeks left, which is really weird to think about. But yes, with that comes a lot of responsibility in getting legislation in and getting your projects finished, getting your funding secured, et cetera. So with that being said, if you have legislation, please communicate with your committee chair so then they can communicate with me. Or if you just want to tell me, that's cool too, whatever you want. Just as long as Jacob and I know like what's going on. Because we need to know, just because we need to make sure everything's going to get passed and everything's, well, not passed necessarily, but everything's going to get brought to the floor and that it has a chance to get brought to the floor. Do you have anything else before? So just another thing, I know like with the whole First Gen Summit, stuff that happened with the Daily Iowa that was posted on social media, I just wanted to reiterate with UISG members, I had brought this up at the executive cabinet meeting, but I wanted to touch on it now for a little bit. Just please be respectful of one another on social media. You all are entitled to your opinions on social media. That's your prerogative for whatever you post. But it becomes my business and Jacob's and UISG's as a whole when other members start commenting on other members' posts in negative ways and ways that reinforce negative behavior. So I just wanted to say that because I got an overwhelming number of comments from other senators, not just senators that were affected by senators that were affected, but also by senators that had noticed that behavior and were uncomfortable seeing that on social media. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention, that people are watching this organization as well as externally, and UISG always has a spotlight on our members and what we say and do. Here in this room, outside of this room, that's always a spotlight that we have because we were elected to these positions and we were assigned to serve in these positions. So I just wanted to make that clear that we need to be respectful online. And if that's an issue and you have questions, I'd be happy to have any discussions outside of this meeting. Just please let me know ahead of time if you would like to meet. So with that, you have
you think we should have pajamas on the last meeting? Let me know, because I think I want to make that happen.
Okay, maybe not. We'll see. Oh yeah, speaking of last meeting, I sent out a Google poll in the Facebook page. I can also send it out in an email later. But our last Senate meeting will be a special session that I'm going to call on either Thursday, April 4th, or Friday, April 5th. I put in that poll, I just kind of gave you the options so I know which one is better to do, so please fill that out, and a decision will be released hopefully in the next day or two. Bless you. I'm not positive, but I can get back to you. We have our UHU leadership meeting tomorrow, and we will be sure to talk about that. Yep.
Alexia, do you mean like an official statement? Like, because, I mean, we posted on social media something that Alex and Hira drafted together, kind of acknowledging it, but I don't, if you're talking about a specific statement.
We can chat about this tomorrow.
Okay.
With that, I'll take a motion to adjourn. Motion to